know, on December 17, 2000, a man walking along the River Thames in West London noticed something unusual floating in the water. As he drew near, he realized that the object was the upper body of a woman. The rest of her body had been severed at the waist. Police were immediately called to the scene near Church Road in Battersea, and the woman's remains were drawn from the river. Medical examiners later speculated that she had been in the water for a couple of weeks and had likely been cut by a sharp instrument, such as a sword. The woman had two distinct characteristics: a tattoo and a twisted lateral incisor tooth that the police hoped would help identify her. It didn't take long for the victim's relatives to come forth after seeing pictures of the tattoo in the local newspapers. The young woman was identified as Zoe Louise Parker, 24, who worked as a prostitute in the Feltham and Hounslow area. Her mother described her as a loving, caring daughter who suffered from learning disabilities. The family was devastated by the loss and appealed for any information concerning their daughter or her murder. Police hoped to find the killer before he struck again. However, they had no substantial leads in the case and no suspects. Less than 2 months later, another horrific crime shocked the community. In late February of that year, three 10-year-old boys fishing in the Regent's Canal at Camden retrieved a bag from the murky water. Upon opening it, the boys were mortified to find human body parts. Police were contacted, and a search of the area immediately commenced. During a sweep of the canal, investigators found approximately 6 bags, which contained various body parts wrapped in bin liners. Bricks had been used to weigh down the bags. Not all of the woman's body was accounted for. The authorities suggested that the rest of her body was either still in the canal, wrapped in bags, or being kept by the killer as a trophy. The woman was later identified as Paula Fields, 31 of Liverpool, who had lived in the Highbury Grove area for a couple of years before her death. She was a mother of two who worked as a prostitute to support her 150-a-day crack cocaine habit. Paula was last seen getting into a red car on December 13. The authorities speculated that a hacksaw was likely used to dismember her body. Initially, Paula's ex-boyfriend, who had a violent criminal history, was suspected of the gruesome murder. However, there was no evidence indicating that he was involved in the crime. Police eventually let the man go and began the search anew for a suspect. In December 2002, a series of equally horrific crimes occurred in the Camden area. Even though the police initially denied any link between the new victims and Zoe and Paula's murders, it was later speculated that the same person might have been involved. The similarities between the cases were just too much to ignore. In January 2003, the police had a new suspect in custody: Anthony Hardy, 51, an unemployed mechanical engineer. His gruesome activities later earned him the nickname the Camden Ripper. Anthony John Hardy was born in 1951 in Burton-on-Trent, Staffordshire, and was a coal miner's son. From an early age, Hardy yearned to escape the lower middle-class lifestyle in which he was raised. He worked hard in school and excelled academically. Ultimately, he was accepted at London's Imperial College to study engineering. During the mid-1970s, Hardy met and married Judith Dwight, with whom he attended university. The couple moved to Tasmania, Australia, where they raised their two boys and two girls. However, from as early as 1982, Hardy displayed symptoms of mental illness. During that year, Hardy tried to kill Judith by bludgeoning her over the head with a water bottle before drowning her in the bath. No charges were filed against Hardy, and he checked himself into a psychiatric clinic in Queensland following the incident. He remained there for several weeks before returning back to Britain. The couple filed for divorce. In 1986, Judith maintained custody of the children and moved back to Britain to begin a new life like Hardy. Shortly after returning to his home country, Rode began stalking Judith, which led to her filing a restraining order against him. Davenport and Doherty claimed that he broke the restriction order, and as a result, he was temporarily imprisoned. Following his release, Hardy sought psychiatric help at outpatient clinics. He was diagnosed with peripheral neuropathy, a disorder that is known to cause depression. He was also diagnosed with manic depression and prescribed medication to reduce symptoms. In the early and mid-1990s, Hardy was homeless and spent much of his time living in various hostels throughout the city. During that time, the party began abusing drugs and alcohol, which further exacerbated his psychological problems. He got into trouble with the law on several more occasions for aggressive behavior and theft, for which he served a short stint in jail. Davenport and Doherty reported that in 1998 Party was arrested for indecent assault after a prostitute claimed he had better, but the charges were later dropped, and he was released. He was also investigated for three others, yet there was insufficient evidence to bring a case against him. However, he was ordered to seek psychiatric counseling, which he took advantage of at a local hospital. He was eventually discharged and referred to outpatient care. In 2000, Hardy moved into a one-bedroom public housing flat on Royal College Street in Camden. This new residence was located a short distance from King's Cross, an area where prostitutes frequented. It was a location that Hardy deliberately chose for that very reason: the neighborhood would become his hunting grounds. In January 2002, Hardy caught police's attention once again when he was caught pouring battery acid into a neighbor's mailbox. At around the same time, a concerned neighbor told police that they believed something was amiss at Hardy's flat. The tip led to a gruesome discovery. When police arrived at Hardy's residence, they found the bedroom door locked. When they broke it open, they found the corpse of a young woman lying naked on his bed. There was evidence the woman suffered from cut marks to her head, bite marks, and bruising, indicating that she might have been murdered. However, pathologists claim that she died of a heart attack and not foul play. The woman was later identified as Sally Rose White, 38, a prostitute from the King's Cross area known to have an addiction to crack cocaine. Sally suffered from brain damage and behavioral problems caused by birth-related spinal cord injury. It was believed that her condition, which worsened with age and lack of treatment coupled with her addiction to drugs, resulted in her heart attack. However, her death from natural causes would later be questioned. When other women's remains were discovered in Hardy's flat on December 30, 2002, a homeless man foraging in garbage bins for food came across a horrible discovery. Within one of the bags, he found human remains, including separate sections of two legs. The homeless man took the remains with them to a nearby hospital, where the police were contacted upon their arrival at the crime scene. Investigators immediately cordoned off the area around the bins, which was located behind a pub on Royal College Street. Officers searched the garbage container and found approximately eight more bags containing various body parts. A young woman's torso was also found in a wheelie bin about 100 yards from the original discovery. The body parts were taken to St. Pancras Mortuary to be examined by pathologists because death was difficult to establish because the heads and hands of the victims were still missing. Yet pathologists determined that the remains were that of two different women who were likely murdered sometime over the Christmas holidays. DNA tests were conducted in the hopes that it would help investigators uncover the identity of the women. A trail of blood leads the police to Hardy's flat, located a short distance from where the bodies were discovered. They promptly obtained a warrant and searched his ground floor apartment, where they found a great deal of incriminating evidence. At the time of the search, the party was nowhere to be found. Investigators discovered in Hardy's flat a hacksaw with human skin still attached to the blade. Moreover, an electric jigsaw power tool was found. Pornographic magazines were scattered about. A woman's black stiletto shoe rested on the windowsill. Blood was found in the bathroom, and a devil's mask lay alongside a note on a table reading "Sally White Rip." However, one of the most incriminating pieces of evidence found in his apartment was a woman's torso wrapped in bin liners. Following the gruesome discovery, a massive search was launched to find Hardy, who had gone missing for several days. It was suspected that he had fled town. However, a CCTV video surveillance camera caught him on tape on January 1, trying to fill a prescription for his diabetic medication at a London hospital party, shaved off his beard in an attempt to alter his appearance during an interview with hospital staff. Officers learned that Hardy spent 4 hours awaiting his medication. It was speculated that he had been drinking because he smelled of alcohol. Party became panicky, and he left the hospital without receiving any medication. After the staff tried to convince him to go to a hostel, a public member had seen Hardy with a young woman named Kelly Ann Nickel, 24, shortly after the Christmas holidays. Family members and police were concerned for her safety, fearing that she might be Hardy's next victim. However, their fears were alleviated when she contacted her parents to let them know she was okay. Even though she had contacted Hardy, who repeatedly tried to persuade her back to his apartment, she did not allow herself to be influenced by him. It was a move that indeed saved her life. On January 2, a local citizen contacted police after spotting Hardy at Great Ormond Street Hospital for Children in central London. Police converged on the scene a short while later and found Hardy in the area where he was last witnessed. He was promptly arrested and held at a local police station. It was there that he would reveal the full extent of his crimes. Not long after Hardy was apprehended, investigators were able to identify two of the victims whose remains were discovered at his home and in the trash bin. They were identified as Elizabeth Selina Vallid, 29 of London, and Bridget McClelland, 34 of Camden. The two women were found to have a lot in common. Elizabeth was a rebellious woman who lived a wayward life from as early as her teens. Born in Nottingham, England, in 1972, Elizabeth was the only child of Iranian professor Hassan Vallid and his British wife, Jackie. The couple lived a short while in America. Yet the marriage broke up when Jackie decided to return with Elizabeth back to Nottingham. At the time, Elizabeth was about 1 year old. Her daughter was a challenging child who mixed with the wrong people as a teenager. She further stated that Elizabeth dropped out of school and moved to London by herself at age 16. From that point, there was little contact between the two. At age 18, Elizabeth began a relationship with a man with whom she lived in London. Shortly into the relationship, Elizabeth became pregnant and later gave birth to her little girl. The three lived with one another for a brief period before Elizabeth left her newly formed family, searching for a different lifestyle. Elizabeth worked in a massage parlor, where she became involved with a married millionaire who set her up in an expensive apartment and provided her with luxurious gifts. After some time, she moved out and started to date other people. She began to take crack cocaine and went back to prostitution to fund her lifestyle. Her addiction eventually led to her death party, which was thought to have played upon his victims' vulnerabilities by luring them to his flat with the promise of money or drugs. It was Elizabeth's torso that was found at Hardy's residence, and her legs that were discovered by a homeless person in the bin. It was difficult for investigators to identify her initially because her hands and head were never found. However, they could obtain a positive idea of her by processing the serial numbers found on her breast implants. Bridget McClelland's identity was revealed on January 6 during a brief hearing at Hendon Court, where Hardy was charged with the murders. Bridget, whose torso and other body parts were found in garbage bins, was identified through her DNA. Like Elizabeth, her head and hands were never found. A native New Zealander and mother of two boys, she worked as a prostitute in Camden. The money she earned from selling her body was mainly used to finance her crack cocaine addiction. Hardy was believed to have been one of her customers, which is how she ended up in his flat. Bridget was murdered on or before December 30, 2000, and two at around the same time Elizabeth was killed. The murders of Elizabeth and Bridget led to a re-the investigation into Sally White's death of alleged natural causes. It was believed that Hardy might have actually murdered her and simply got away with it. When the pathologist incorrectly diagnosed her cause of death as a heart attack, they just had to prove their theory. However, after a brief inquest, it was determined that Sally had died of natural causes related to chronic heart disease. The findings would later be disproved, following surprising new evidence brought forth by Hardy's murder trial that began at the Old Bailey Courthouse in November 2003. During the onset of the trial, he made a startling confession. He pled guilty to the murders of Elizabeth and Bridget and that of Sally White, who was thought to have died of natural causes. He had previously denied murdering the women. The confession discounted the conclusions of previous pathological reports into Sally's death and questioned the credibility of the medical examiners that worked on her case. During the trial, it was revealed how each woman succumbs to their gruesome demise. Hardy was said to have lured all of the women to his apartment with the offer of money. He then engaged in extreme sex with the women before strangling them. Hardy was a pornography-obsessed necrophiliac who achieved sexual gratification by posing his victims' nude bodies after death and taking explicit photos of their naked corpses. In fact, his primary motivation for committing the murders was so that he could photograph them. It was also suggested that at the time police found Sally White Pardee was likely in the process of preparing her body for photographs, she, too, would have likely ended up in the trash bin had the police not interrupted his gruesome activities. Pardee had taken about 44 pornographic pictures of Elizabeth and Bridget, which he allegedly sent to a friend. The pictures were later turned into the police. They claim that one of the macabre photographs depicted Elizabeth lying posed on the bed with her facial features obscured by devil mask and a baseball hat, both of which were later found at Hardy's flat. After Hardy had finished with his victims during the search, he used a hacksaw to dismember their bodies in his bathtub. Evidence of his victims' blood was found in his bathroom when the police interviewed neighbors after discovering the bodies. They claimed to have heard drilling sounds at all hours of the day. The judge overhearing the case, Justice Keith, said to Hardy after the trial, "Only you know for sure how your victims met their deaths. But the unspeakable indignities to which you subjected the bodies of your last two victims to satisfy your depraved and perverted needs are in no doubt." On November 25, 2003, Pardee's were given 3 life sentences for the murders, and the judge would later decide whether he could ever be released on parole. In January 2002, following the discovery of Sally White's body and Hardy's arrest for having poured acid into a neighbor's mailbox, he was detained in the mental ward at St. Luke's Hospital in Muswell to undergo a psychological evaluation. While Hardy was being evaluated, he made a sport of conning psychiatrists. A friend of his said that Hardy believed he was cleverer than they were. However, mental health experts saw through him. Despite Hardy's efforts to fool them, psychiatrists found Hardy to be a risk to the community, especially women. Dr. Alan Stewart Reed warned that his behavior is characterized by impulsiveness, lack of forethought about the consequences of his actions, seriously irresponsible behavior, inability to learn from experience, and a lack of concern for others' feelings. Moreover, Stuart Reed also said that there was a strong chance that if he were reintegrated back into society, it would likely reoffend and cause others serious physical or psychological harm. Despite repeated warnings from healthcare professionals, Hardy was released in November of that year. A panel made up of 3 healthcare managers decided after having found Hardy of minor threat to society. Davenport and Doherty said that their decision was allegedly based on psychiatrists' reports that he was of low to medium risk. However, the panel actually failed to read the report put forth by psychiatrists that warned against Hardy's potentially violent behavior. It turned out to be a fatal error. A spokeswoman for the Camden and Islington Mental Health Trust confirmed that Hardy was under supervision throughout Christmas and even kept an appointment with the supervisory group outside the hospital on December 30th. The day the vagrant first discovered the body parts behind a pub in Camden Town. Yet even though he was under supervision, it was constrained. Health supervisors were actually so scared of him. They refused to go to his council flat, agreeing to meet him only in cafes. Their fears should have been enough to raise the alarm bells about his behavior, but nothing was done about it, and Hardy remained free to roam the streets. Following Hardy's arrest, a public inquiry was held to determine why he was released when he was such an obvious threat to society. There was increasing pressure to dismiss the panel of 3 health managers from their duties. However, some argued that the panel should not have been faulted for falling victim to Hardy's manipulative, psychotic behavior and that the blame rests solely on the offender. Regardless, the fact remains that had Hardy been kept in the hospital, Elizabeth and Bridget would likely be alive today. To date, it's unknown. Suppose Hardy was responsible for the murders of Zoe Parker and Paula Fields. In that case, however, police continue to believe that the cases are likely connected. Moreover, it's believed that Hardy was also responsible for up to 5 or 6 other area murders that bore marked similarities to the ones for which he was convicted. Yet, there's not enough evidence available that directly implicates him in the murders. In actuality, few women crossed Hardy's path during the peak of his murder spree and lived to tell about it. The only 2 exceptions the police were aware of were that of Kelly Ann Nickel and Frances Mayhew, 25. The stories they recounted lend some insight into how hard he may have lured some of his victims to their deaths in December 2002 before the bodies being found in the garbage bins. Frances received a phone call from Hardy claiming that he had her handbag, which she allegedly lost. He gave her his address and told her if she wanted it, she could come by his flat and collect the bag. Mayhew felt uncomfortable about going to a stranger's house to retrieve her bag and contacted the police for advice on what she should do. Frances was assured that there is no danger in going alone to the man's house, but it would be in her best interest if she informed someone of where she was. Still feeling nervous about going to Hardy's house by herself, she asked if her landlady would accompany her. It was a decision that probably saved her life. When they arrived at Hardy's residence, Frances's landlady waited in the car while she went to fetch her handbag. When Hardy answered the door, his unusual demeanor and the bizarre decor of his house immediately formed a negative impression on her. Frances said that her first impressions were of an unattractive man in awful tracksuit trousers far too low down his waist. Moreover, she noticed that the walls in his house were decorated with numerous black crosses and odd pictures of human anatomy. Hardy tried to entice her in, but she refused. In fact, he told Frances that if she didn't come into the house, he wouldn't give her the bag. Frightened by Hardy's strange behavior, Frances told him to keep it and walked back to her car. Irritated at her refusal to come into the house, Hardy threw her presenter. After 3 days, she received letters and Christmas cards from him, which prompted her to call the police. Shortly after that, Frances went away for the holidays. Upon her return, she learned the murders he committed. Had he been at all violent and tried to drag me into the flat or something? The likelihood of me being in small pieces right now is very high, she said. Kelly Nickel was another potential victim that narrowly escaped Hardy's murderous wrath. In December 2002, Hardy repeatedly tried to persuade Nickel to come into his flat. However, her instinct warned her not to do it. Had Kelly not followed it, she would likely have fallen victim to Hardy, forensic pathologist Freddie Patel, who subsequently concluded that White had died of a heart attack despite the circumstances. Patel later came under scrutiny for this and other findings in his career, including the 2009 death of Ian Tomlinson, resulting in a suspension from the government's register of pathologists pending an inquiry. In 2012, his name was erased from the General Medical Council's medical register, meaning that he can no longer practice medicine in the United Kingdom. Hardy pleaded guilty to a charge of criminal damage and claimed he had no knowledge of how White came to be in his flat due to his drinking problem. In custody, Hardy was transferred to a psychiatric hospital under Section 37 of the Mental Health Act 1983, remaining there until November 2002. In May 2010, a high court judge decided that Hardy should never be released from prison, placing him on the list of whole-life tariff prisoners. This is one of those sporadic cases in which life should mean life. The fact is, no one really knows why Hardy did the things he did, and he took those secrets with him. On the 26th of November 2020, he died of sepsis at the age of 69.